afterwards after
Yeah,
the
thank you.
training.
Great. Yeah, so the recording has started. So what we are discussing is standard object and custom object, right? So Salesforce has two things called a standard object and a custom object. Standard objects are tables, which are tables that are provided automatically by Salesforce. Okay? And you cannot delete these tables, right? These tables are already there. So what can be the examples? Account, contact, user, product, opportunity. These are we covered in last session, right? Opportunity, product, price book entry, right? These objects, these standard objects, and many, many standard objects we have. We'll see that in details. Custom objects are tables that are created by you as an admin. Yeah, why will you create new tables if Salesforce is providing so many tables? Because probably these are the standard features of any sales or service process, but you need some more information to store that is specific to your business. That is not possible to store in just extending the fields, right? In that case, you will create new tables and you will associate these tables probably with these tables, or this can be independent also, right? So association is very vital. Before we move into the association, let's look at the fields once again. So if this is a standard object and this is custom object, standard objects also has standard fields. Custom also object also has standard fields. How many standard fields will a custom object have? Have you checked that? No, anybody tried it? In UI, you will see four fields. We'll look into that right now. Okay, so standard objects will have standard fields, that is automatic fields created by Salesforce, provided by Salesforce. Custom object will also have standard fields. Custom object, when you create a new table, Salesforce automatically creates four fields for you. Yeah, we'll see those fields. Apart from that, standard objects, you can extend standard objects with custom fields, that is new fields that is created by you. Okay. Similarly, custom objects, of course, you have created to create or extend using custom fields. But mainly, custom fields is the main thing which you will do in custom object. In standard objects, mainly the standard fields are the things which you want to use, right? So standard object, custom object, both are clear. How do we make association between these tables? Last day we saw account is connected to contact. Account is connected to opportunity, right? And what is the relationship? This is the relationship. 1:N, 1:N. That is 1-to-many, 1-to-many, right? How is this relationship created? Anybody want to give it a try? Come on,
look up.
Right. Yes. So in contact table, there is a field called account ID. And what kind of field is this? This is a lookup field. In opportunity object also, there is a field called account ID. And it is also a lookup field. What does a lookup field store?
It stores the account ID.
What is account ID?
So, it's a unique field on the account side, like which contains all this information of that particular account.
No. Unique field does not contain information about other fields. When we go and see any table, there is any table in Salesforce, there is automatically a column called ID field that is created by Salesforce. And that creates an auto-generated ID. Every record will have an auto-generated ID, record one, record two, right? And then you have specific field values which you put. So think about this as account. This is the ID field, and this every record will have a record generated here. What does this represent? This is a unique value which can represent this whole row. It's like a serial number, kind of a serial number, not serial number, like a passport of your country, like a primary key. So this is called primary key. When I am using this value in another table, why will I use this value in another table? Contact also has a CID, contact ID, record 1, record 2, record 3. Similarly, here I say account ID is there. Here, I will put AID 1, AID 1, AID 2. This is the lookup field. That means this is the foreign key, because this is the primary key of another table. I am coming and storing here. Why I am storing here? In order to associate this row to a row in this table, account table. Right? So if I have AID 1 here, AID 1 here, that means the first row of account table is associated to these two rows. That means one to many relationship. Clear? So lookup field is one of the fields through which we create this relationship across tables. Similarly, there is another field called master detail. What is the difference between lookup and master detail? Lookup field can be created on all objects. Master detail can be created on custom objects. Okay. Lookup field parent record, if it is deleted, that does not have any impact on child records. What is parent record? What is child record?
Account is like a parent record and like contact is child record.
Absolutely right. So if the account is deleted, nothing happens to the child records. Only if that field, that lookup field will be blank. Right? That will become blank. But in master detail, when you delete the parent record, the child record is automatically deleted. Clear? So what do we call this? We call this cascade delete. Okay. Lookup may or may not be mandatory. Lookup by default is not mandatory. You can make it a mandatory field, but master detail is always mandatory. You have to provide a value. Otherwise, the record cannot be saved. Yeah. And there is another impact, which we'll see in detail. What does it mean? In maybe the last classes, but that is important for you to remember right now, but we'll go into that. Lookup field, if you add to any object, does not matter. No impact to other fields. Right? Master detail, if you create a master detail field on any custom object, the owner field is removed. There is no owner field from now on. If there is a master detail field created on a custom object. Clear? And that's fine. I think the rest of the part will gradually come into subsequent session. I don't want to
continue. Can you repeat it once again?
Which one?
This one only.
Yeah. The owner, I will show this all. We'll see this all happening. You just remember that when a lookup field is created, nothing happens to any other fields, no impact to other fields. But when master detail field is created, the owner field is removed. Owner is a standard field provided by Salesforce. Very, very important field. Very, very important field. So this why is the very, very important field removed by Salesforce? We'll get into that details in subsequent classes. Yeah. Probably the most important field in Salesforce. Owner field is the most important field of Salesforce. Okay. That is fine. So now we'll see everything. Before we see Salesforce and we'll see the fields and details, there is one more critical sales process which we want to cover. So what happens when a salesman wakes up? How does he start his business or his day? Any idea? Any wild guesses will do. Does he start by creating an account? Will that work?
Maybe by creating lead.
You think yourself as a salesman. You're starting your day, right?
Maybe.
You do not have any customer in hand.
You will find the opportunities. You will find the opportunities for the day.
Now, how will you work in Salesforce? Okay, forget Salesforce. How will you work in your daytime? How will you start your day? How what is your plan?
Cold calling.
Cold calling to whom?
So directly customer.
Where will you get his number?
Leads.
If someone put the leads.
Who will create the lead? You are the salesman. Somebody will create the lead for you. Then what is your job?
To convert those leads into an opportunity.
That's the second step. First, you have to get the leads. Where will you get the leads? Okay.
Yeah, we get leads from the third party resources. Like we buy leads from.
Buy leads. What is leads?
Leads are like prospect customers for us.
Prospective customer. What does prospective customer means? Prospective customer means a person who may or may not become your customer. Is it?
Yeah.
Okay. So what happens is that it's just similar that you know there is a potential that this person might be your customer. You identify some people and try to reach them. That is the salesman's job, right? Somebody can knock your door. Are you interested in purchasing this product? You see the salesman knocking at your doors, right? Do they know that you are interested or not? They do not know, right? After talking to you or trying to convince you, you may or may not purchase that product, right? For B2B business is no different. For B2C, what example I was giving as a salesman knocking to your door is a B2C business, which is business to a company is trying to sell to individual people. In Salesforce, most of the time we'll discuss B2B business, which is business to business. A company will sell to another company. So what will happen? Probably you will reach out to some contacts of that company. Yeah, this business with whom you want to do business or this company. Find out some people who work there, probably in LinkedIn. You will reach out to them, knock them, ask them, are you interested? He will say, get out, don't disturb me. And that turns out. And he said, no, seems interesting. Can we talk? Yeah, there is a two outcomes of a lead, right? Either he kicks you out or he says, okay, let's talk next. Isn't it? So all the people, all the individuals, right? These are not companies, these are individuals. All the individuals whom you are hitting throughout your day, these are leads. They are may or may not be your customers, right? Purchasing leads is just making a job easier for you. You are responsible for creating leads. A salesman is the person who could identify leads and convert them. That is the whole process. Now, what is the should we store the leads in Salesforce? What do you think?
Yes.
Why? A person who has not even done business with you, what is the point?
Maybe in some future they will convert the leads, at least store.
Great. So one possibility is that future opportunities. Probably yes. They do not have budget right now. They said
yes,
not able to purchase right now, but it looks interesting. Probably 1 year down the line, I might think about it. So you want to store that lead so that you do not like forget that, right? You can hit back this lead once again. Try to convert them once again. And what else? Any other reason? Guys, if you're not talking, you can put yourself on mute, and I think you can put your videos off so that it becomes faster for you. You can see somebody is on video, like Harshavardhan Challa is on video.
No, I'm not in video.
Yeah, anyway. Okay. Harsha, I'm putting you on mute. You unmute you when you wanted to speak. Yeah. So any other reason, guys, go ahead. So future opportunity, certainly, if the customer, I might be, the chances of re-hitting him. That is good. That is one good option. What is the other reason? Why should I store leads? Maybe to analyze. Which kind of people are saying yes to us? Which kind of people are not saying no to us, right? So that we can understand how to improve ourselves for better lead conversions, right? Third and most important is that you are a salesman. Your conversion rate in industry is around 10%. So in the whole day, if you have hit 10 people, only one will be converted. So throughout the throughout the day, what you have done, you don't want to show your company. Why will they pay you? They will say that you have only converted one person. You have done nothing throughout the day. That's not the case, right? Throughout the day, you have worked. But that is unsuccessful. But that's the life of a salesman. He's working. He's trying. And one of the leads is getting converted. Right, 10% ratio normally. If you are a better salesman, probably more. But throughout the day, you are doing some unproductive work. But you have to show that to your company that yes, I have spent time on this person, isn't it? 9 other people who has not got business, but still the company will know that you are giving a try, isn't it? A thorough justification of what you're doing throughout the day. Okay. Primarily these 3 reasons why I will be storing the leads also. Future opportunities will also include cross-selling, but that we can do a deal in a different way anyway. So these are the 3 primary reasons why we store the lead. So how will the CRM be now updated with the process? So my first step will not be creating an account or contact. It will be creating a lead. A person who may or may not buy my product. What will happen next? I will convert that lead, if he's interested, to a account and a contact. Got it? And optionally, a opportunity. Opportunity is the deal. The lead gets converted to an account. To an account, to a contact, and optionally, a opportunity. How will I get all this information from the lead if this is automatic conversion? A lead object has a company field that identifies this lead belongs to which company. This individual belongs to which company. When the lead conversion happens, this individual's whole information is copied into contact. And we create a new contact record. And this field, company information, using this field, we create the account record. Only one field. Is it clear now?
Yeah.
Good. Now we will see everything in Salesforce, this whole process. Lead to contact, then account contact, and then opportunity. And how we work on opportunity and everything on Salesforce. How will this work? Right. Let's see how a salesman works. Yeah. So this is Salesforce, of course, Lightning version. People are using classics. A classic can switch to Lightning just by going here. So if you are in classic like this, here, it's the same story though, but you can switch to Lightning. You will have this button here and switch to Lightning. Yeah. So we'll only focus on Lightning because classic is sunsetting very soon. So which application should I use? A salesman should use a service application or a sales application?
Sales,
right? So this is the sales application I have. I will switch my application to a sales application. What are my first step out of this, as I discussed? Lead, right?
Yes,
leads. So if I go to the leads, this is the lead. This is the lead landing page. Okay, every tab will have its own landing page. That will show all the records there in that table. We discussed or we showed that in the last table. There is a list view called all open leads. They will show all the leads that is which is there in the system right now. Similarly, in the opportunity, we'll go to all opportunity. You will see all the opportunities that is there in the application right now. Okay, so let's go there. So I will start with the lead. We'll go to the lead button. You can create from here. Or you can go and use this new lead button. It's the same thing, no difference. What are the minimum, bare minimum information required? You see, this is an individual, right? You're asking a last name, first name, right? Let's put some information. Maybe Sunil Gavaskar. Yeah. And what is the company? Maybe BCCI. Yeah, anything else? You see, this is a defaulted already. So if you don't even put values, it doesn't matter. It is the default value which is starting with. You can go ahead and change that. If you have already started working on the lead, you can change this to working. Or you can already have discussed and that is not get converted. You just want to show that you have worked with this customer. Then you close the lead directly. When we create the lead, at that point only you either convert or convert it. But not usually, you will start with a not contacted version. Is the lead which is probably purchased from any third party, right? So you get a phone number from this guy or so on. Maybe let's give a phone number to this guy. So this is the phone number wherein I will be calling this guy, right? And this is the status changes. You can go ahead and change the status here. That will change the path here. Otherwise, you can go and click here and you can mark this as complete also. Simple. It's the same thing. What you can do on this lead, you can make a call, right? You can log a call here. So maybe call, I called. Is interested. Yeah. When I say this shows a history that somebody called this person, right? You can have a new task. Probably you are setting a meeting with him, right? So probably, or you are sending an email to him, right? Do anything. You can extend this to different tasks which you want to do with this people, right? Maybe I will send a email tomorrow with some status which he wants to know. So I create a task for me to remind me that after 3 days, I have to send a mail. Or probably I will create a meeting with him, right, on this time. And we are safe. And I schedule a meeting for him, right? All these activities which I want to do, this is under activity tab of this same object. It's a lead detail screen in that you have several objects. Yeah. Activity is the most crucial object. Details shows other fields of the lead. You see other, you can directly do an inline change. Or you can go ahead and use the edit button, wherein you have multiple fields to change. Inline editing will just work for one field at a time, right? When you're happy, either you close, it's not converted. He is not interested in a business or he will go and convert. So I will hit the convert button. Now you see what is happening. The company field here, it is getting used to create an account. Okay. And they will create a contact with the same values like Sunil Gavaskar. So they will create a contact with the same name. So they are copying the lead information to the contact. And they are optionally telling you to create an opportunity. And there is some values which you have to put it here. You can also say, I don't want to create the opportunity. Yeah. So it is optional. But let's create the opportunity also. Let's say BCCI January deal. Yeah. And I convert. What happens? Three records gets created at three different tables from the lead record. One record in account table, one record in contact table, one record in opportunity table. And these are associated to each other, right? We also already know account is the parent of contact. Account is the parent of opportunity. Why does the lead get distributed up in this way? Any idea? What is the point? Why we could not store that in either the lead object or probably one object, customer object, something like that. Lead to customer, that would be easier, right? One table to one table migration. Why this one table to three table migration? What is the benefit of it? Sorry, I'm not able to hear you.
Yeah. Maybe different department of people working a different object.
No.
And like maybe like for one account, like there will be a different contact, like for the same company, like we will have different people at different positions.
That's correct.
So
the lead is basically one individual, one company. But when you are doing a deal with him, you need more information to save. This one object model will not work. So you have to go to a more sophisticated data model. What is this sophisticated model help you do? This company, you can store multiple contacts. This lead is one contact, right? This lead has become one contact, but there can be multiple contacts with whom you have to do. How will one table store this? It will not be possible, right? You have to associate one account. You don't want to duplicate your accounts. You have one account that is connected to multiple contacts that you cannot do in one object model. That is the lead. Is unsophisticated table. One table is not able to handle that. In order to normalize the table, we have to normalize the table so that we can store this value with proper associations. So account and contact can be many. So I will store the account related information is one table. I don't want to duplicate this. I want to store the individuals in a different table and I want to associate these two together. Contacts can be multiple. And opportunities also can be multiple. This account can have multiple opportunities, right? That is the whole reason why I have now broken one table into three tables. That gives me the flexibility to create more and more contacts, more and more opportunities for the same account. Got it? So let's see. If I go to contact, I see BCCI getting created. And if you go to detail screen, you can definitely go and put more information. What type of industry is this? Maybe the direct customer or channel customer, banking industry or something of that sort. You put more details as that is required. You enrich the value of your customer. And this is the details screen, right? Details tab, if you see that. On the top, you have the most important fields that for that contact, which is beneficial for your company. If you want to change this, if you say that website and account is not very crucial information for me, I want the industry to be here. That is possible. Okay. So this is the highlighted fields. In detail fields, we'll get all the fields values of this object, of this record. And in related, I can see if I have any related tables that is in link to that. What the related tables I created? So one record in contact, one record in opportunity, right? I can go ahead and create a child record here from here itself. I can say Ravi Shastri. There's a new field that's got created. new contact. If you go to the contacts, you will see Ravi Sastri and Sunil Gavaskar getting created. Both are associated to BCCI account. It's a new table, another table, right? But my BCCI lead was only, my contact point was only Sunil Gavaskar at some point. Now I have both Sunil Gavaskar and Ravi Sastri. Isn't it? And I can extend it more and more and more. In the opportunity, probably I will see this is the BCCI January deal. I can create a new order for February. Yeah. These are the crucial fields of an opportunity, a stage, and a closed rate. So what happens when you automatically create the opportunity from lead generation? Can we go and compare these two? Let's go to the opportunity. Can you deal? You see, both the stages are prospecting. And what is the closed rate for January? This month end. Okay, automatic, that is getting put by Salesforce. But if you go to the next opportunity, which is you created, sorry. You chose your own date. Okay, so that is the only difference. So, but there, if you are creating manually, you can of course create a new account manually from here. You might bypass a new lead. You might say CAB. Yeah. This is a new account. And this is directly a customer you're creating on the system. You are bypassing the lead generation. Probably this is an existing customer. You moved from an old CRM to a new CRM. Then you will not create a new lead, right? Because this is an existing customer. Probably you are using Siebel. From there, you have started using Salesforce from today. What will happen? You will create new accounts, which will be copied from your CRM, Siebel system. Yeah. So probably CAB is one of them. Then you will also directly create a contact. You can create a contact from here. You can directly create a contact from here also. Here is a new button. Here is a new button. Both the same. I can go ahead and I can put Gaurav Ganguly. And I can search for, this is the lookup field, as you see. I can search. And I say save. When I say save on contact screen, I can see my account here. If I go back to this contact in account, I see contact associated with it. Yeah. So in related list, I can see childs. On contacts, I can see the parent automatically as a field. Yeah. Very important for this. And what is this? This is a lookup field, right? So I create a lead, I convert a lead to account, contact, and opportunity. I can directly create account and contacts also, bypassing leads. I can directly create opportunity from scratch also. Yeah. So let's see what is a general deal. So in deal, you have several stages, right? Till it is closed or it is lost. They are interested, but probably in the final moment, they did not like your quote or they didn't like your prices. It might so happen, right? You did not give a good discount to them. So they said that I got a better discount from somebody else. I am interested in your product, but it's not working out. The deal did not work out. It may happen. Right? In the deal stage also, you can contact customers and so on. So all this information, which you saw that you have contacted Sunil Gavaskar, this all comes and shows up in your opportunity. You see? All the activities are getting created. Now, if you can go and change the stages like this, mark as a current stage. You can go and edit this stage also from here. And if you change the stage, you said the probability is automatically changed. You see, 20%, 50% based on that. So now you're on the need analysis stage, right? you can go ahead and put the stage anytime, anywhere, and market it. But what is the crucial information that is missing? What are you selling to this customer? Is it there? This deal does not capture it till now, right? But you need that information somehow. In the details, you see all the fields of the account: lead source, order number, main competitor. All of that is important for what is the amount or the expected revenue. These all things are good. But what are the products am I selling to these guys? So here you see, I can choose my products. You see, choose price book. If you have multiple catalogs in your company, multiple menu cards in your company, then you have to choose a price book. Otherwise, the standard price book will only be applicable. Then you don't have to choose a price book. Or if you don't choose a price book, always the standard price book is selected. Here, I can go ahead and choose my products. There are some sample products out there. So before I do that, this is a screen. Which these values are coming from which object do you think? Come on, last class.
Price book.
Price book. Does price book stores list price? The price is stored
opportunity
in
opportunity product.
Huh?
Opportunity product.
Opportunity product is when a product is associated to the deal. You are now selecting a product. When you're selecting a product, of course, you are selecting from a menu card. This looks like a menu card, isn't it? If you go to a restaurant, you see the dishes and you see the prices, right? Exactly that is what you're seeing on the screen, isn't it? This is a menu card. This is a price book screen, but the values are coming from which object? Is it coming from price
products.
Book? Huh?
Products object.
Products object. Products. Products has all the products. Your menu card may or may not contain that product. Maybe you sell a shoe in US only. You don't sell the shoe in India. So if you have a price book for or menu card for India, that shoe will not show up, right? That will not be displayed. So this is definitely not a product screen. What is the menu card object? First, let's see. Somebody said price book, right?
Yeah.
So price book object is the parent object, right? Individual entries are like this. Price book, probably this is price book name is standard. So this object on the top, this value is coming from the price book object. But what are these values coming from? Where are we storing the list price? Come on, last session you've completely forgotten. Seems like. Let's go back. It's very crucial to understand these things, otherwise, it's not really productive.
From the mapping object,
yes. What is the name of the mapping object?
Opportunity product.
Opportunity product is the mapping object which stores the product that is selected for the deal. What you are seeing on the screen is the menu card. Where does the menu card values come from? Just revise the last class. It seems like nobody remembers anything from the last class.
We have in the menu card last time, we have India and USA.
Go ahead.
We have taken the example of India and USA and the price in the India and price in the USA.
Yeah. So what you're seeing right now in the last class, we had a price book. Right? In price book, we took two objects, right? India and USA. Let's take another object here. It's called standard. That you are seeing on screen right now, isn't it? No difference. So price book has three records. Products object is there. Product one, product two, and so on. Right? Product code is there. Anything, all details are there. Product is there. Now, how does a menu card be is getting created? How are we associating a menu card with product? We talked about a mapping object, right?
Price book entry.
Absolutely right. Absolutely right. So this is my mapping object, right? What fields you will have? Price book will have its own ID. I will have product ID. I will have price book ID. And what important fields will I have here? Product one, price book one, product two, price book one. Right? What information should I need to place here that is important for mapping? If I'm selling the shoe, let's take our example. Price book is standard. Standard is shoe, cap. So in standard price book, when I'm selling shoe, what is a crucial information in the menu card I need, which is missing right now?
Price,
absolutely. I will say $10. I will say $20. In my standard price book, this product will be listed with $10 price. And cap will be listed in this price book for $20. Why am I not storing this price book in product table or price book table?
Because for the different locations, we have different prices.
Absolutely. So it's a mapping that wherein you will store the price, isn't it? So if I go back to my screen, this is the menu card I'm seeing. Just give me 1 second. Yeah, this is the menu card I'm seeing. So where these values are primarily coming from? These are the list prices. Exactly. And here's the product names. And I already am seeing the association with my price book. So this value is coming from price book entry. That is a mapping table. Now I select my dishes, which I want to purchase from this menu card. Right? The list price is there, right? The same table. Now, which table is this? The sales price has come from price book entry. But this table, these values are getting stored where?
Quantity.
Quantity. Quantity is the name of the table. This is which table?
Order.
Which object are we storing this information?
Order.
Order. Order. There is no order object in Salesforce. We are talking about opportunity. Right?
Yes.
Order object in Salesforce is a different beast. We will talk about that later. But what is this object here? For us, the order is opportunity. In this opportunity, in this order, we have selected the products. You see now the quantity is getting, they are asking for quantity. And that is a mandatory field. Why quantity is mandatory field? And which table has quantity as the mandatory field? Guys, you have to mug up the last session. Yeah. Otherwise, you'll keep forgetting what is happening.
So it is opportunity product.
Yes, it is opportunity product. Why it is opportunity product? Why it is opportunity product?
Yeah, because it has the price as well as the this quantity field over there.
Price? Okay. Let's talk about opportunity product. So I have the deal, January. I have the product, shoe and cap. I have the mapping object, right? Because I have to associate shoe and cap with January, isn't it? What will I do? January, shoe, January, cap. This is the order, right? Which is happening. So what crucial information is that needed here? How many of them am I ordering, right? Quantity. Why is the quantity not getting stored here? Why is the quantity not getting stored in order? Why it is not getting stored in products and why it is not getting stored in opportunity? Why are we storing in mapping object?
Yeah, the quantity will be different for each month and
absolutely
for right. Each product.
Absolutely right. And this is an entry field, right? Price book entry is a display table from which you choose. And opportunity product is a table which you wherein you create values so that the orders completes. So here you have to give a quantity, 5, 10. Yeah, exactly. That is what we are seeing on the screen. Isn't it? The products and the quantity. So this is getting stored in my opportunity product table, which is a child of opportunity table. Is a child of both parents, right? Opportunity and product. Since I am on opportunity already, I don't need to show the opportunity again and again on these lines. I am only showing the products. Because it's the same opportunity, right? If you see the table, this will be the same opportunity. I am on the context of the opportunity right now. So I will only show what are the different products and what is the different quantity. You insert this and all these values get stored in opportunity product table. Okay. And finally, you close this. Either you make it a won or a lost deal. If you have won it, then everything is successful. And the salesman moves on to a new opportunity. His sales cycle is complete. Right? Okay. So let's see these values in backend. What did we create first? Leads, right? Which lead did we create today? The lead has been converted to account and contact. So I will come back first. Okay. Let's go to the January deal. Right? This is the January deal. Let's copy this. Let's go to opportunity of. Ibu, let me know if it's getting too technical for you.
Sure, Nimish. This is good.
Okay, good. So this is the opportunity table. This is the order table, right? Wherein I'm putting the orders. Yeah. So maybe I will put a filter here. Name. Yeah, name. Let's put general deal and query it. You see, I can have multiple values like ID, like stage. All these fields, you can choose control and you can choose whatever field you want to display. Yeah. This amount, close date, this is the ID. Where can we see this on in Screenline? So of course we are on this opportunity. The ID is on the top, which we saw in this URL, right? DRAA2. This is DRAA2, right? This is the same ID. I have the closed date. 515 and 975. This is exactly the same. And this is closed one. Stage is also showing up. So I can see this in the backend in the table format. Where are we storing these two information? This products and industrial values. These are not getting stored here, right? Is there a product column? Nothing. I can check the price book ID here. You see? There is a price book ID. If you want to see view in Salesforce, go and there. And you see, this is a standard price book. Yeah. So in this standard price book, we have a related list. And these are the price book entries. Yeah. We can see all the products and their prices. This is the menu card, isn't it? This is the menu card in full form. I have the name of the menu card on the top, and I have individual dishes, and I have the individual prices with the product code and so on. All the information is here. This is the master table from which you choose when you are creating an order. So now, in the order, we are where is this opportunity? This is the price book, right? So let's copy this. Know if I could copy this, but let's see. I copied. Let's go to the price book. The price book is called price book 2 in backend. Okay. Yes, sir. Let's query everything. Why should we bother? Query ID and name. There is not much, right? There are two price book I can see here. Yeah, standard price book. Yeah. It's the same ID here anyway. So this is the one price book only. Yeah. Which is getting stored here. Standard price book. And that is exactly here. And so where are we storing basically these information, price book entries? We are storing in price book entry. Maybe I will copy this from here. I have a price book entry table, right? And let's query everything here. This is a child table, which will have two IDs, product price book ID and product ID, because this is a mapping object, right? And there is a unit price. Unit price is the listed price. Yeah. So these are the values of all the product price is there. What is the price book ID? Oh, it's all the same, right? Standard price book, 34 items. Yeah, you all. Okay. I think it's a duplicated list. Two times is coming up. Yeah, correct. So this is the product ID, which is changing. Can I change this product IDs to show actual products? If I go here in the settings and try to change this to that's fine. This needs to be checked. If it's not checked, allow SQL parent queries. If you do this and go back to this mapping table, yeah, instead of price book, you can traverse to the parent and replace this with name. This will not work, but still I will check. No, I think underscore relationships is not working here. Something, some problem, so we'll check. Anyway, so this basically is the mapping table of both the parents of the price book table, right? You see product ID and price book ID. These are basically the association, again, the lookup fields on price book entry. And this price book entry is basically the child of the menu card, which is exactly what you're seeing on this screen. And this is exactly what you are also selecting. And this is exactly what is been showed up when you go to an opportunity and choose the product. Exactly the same thing, right? The 17 entries will come up. Okay, so now when we choose this values, let's go to the opportunity object. We chose the name. There are many opportunities, of course. But we are looking at the BCCI January deal. Right? We already have that. You can put ID here. Yeah. Now, there is a child object, we already talked about it, opportunity product, which is storing individual products of that opportunity, right? Of the deal. Where do we get, that is backend is called, that table name is called opportunity line items. Okay, it has its own ID, every table has. And you see, these are the mapping object. Mapping object will have the ID of the individual parents, exactly what is you are seeing here. And what is a crucial field here? Quantity, right? And it picks up the list price from the price book entry and stores it here. Because in the deal also, you need the actual price. But this price is something which is automatically extracted from your price book entry and put it here. But here, so you cannot enter this manually. It is chosen. And this is the quantity. This is automatically calculated based on the quantity. List price into quantity is the list price which will come up in this line item. Okay, so child object, mapping object of both opportunity and product. What is the product? Here is the product. The price book entry is there for information. This is repeating, you see, but the product ID is not same. Product ID is changing. The opportunity ID is same. And in opportunity ID, of the price book entry is already there. So price book entry in this table is not very important. It's just a duplicated value. But the price book entry is already selected in the opportunity level. So individual line items does not need it, but it is easier for you to make any queries and so on based on the price book entry. That is why it is also copied in the line items. But this is the main table. It's a child table of both opportunity and product, which is storing individual quantities of each product, right? And associating that to this opportunity. Right? So we saw how the data is stored and what is the general way a salesman is doing a business and how he's using Salesforce. Now his office is clear. How he uses Salesforce is very clear. How does an admin now use, or you, when you work as an admin, because you are a technical guy, you are helping the salespeople do their business. How do you add value? So let's see if I have a BCCI and I go to detail screen, do I see a GST number here anywhere? No GST number, right? No field to store GST value. Right? But if you do business in India, GST is absolutely necessary, right? A few years back, the GST came into picture. There's a gap I can see here. I can put a new field here, isn't it? Let's go ahead. So our admins only work not on these screens. Admin works on these setup screens. So this is the your office. So you click it and this opens up for you. This is not available for general users or salesmen. Right? You work here. So if you go to the object manager tab, it will show up all the standard fields of Salesforce and custom fields you have created. How do you identify a standard object and a custom object? Is a standard object or custom object? Okay. So anything which does not end with __C is a standard object. Anything wherein API name is __C is a custom object. Clear? If you see the label, through by seeing the label, you will not be able to identify it. You have to see the API name. If it is __C, it is a custom object. If it is __C in the field also, it is a custom field. As I said, account is a standard object. I can go ahead and create a custom field here. I go to the new. And what kind of field is GST? I want to create a GST field, right? And on my account screen, probably I choose a text field. There are other fields, many, many options you see, right? You can create a lookup field, checkbox, currency, date, date time, email, geolocation, number, percentage, phone. Why so many fields? Everything can be text, right? What is the benefit of having so many different field categories? How does help us by any chance? Any ideas?
It indicates what type of information is stored into the field.
How does that matter? On top, you will say that this is email ID. That is enough, right? Why the selection of data type is important?
No other entries. Anyone can put there. Like if it is an email field, no one can enter the number or any other thing.
That's correct. So it creates an automatic data validation. If I choose a plain text field for everything, then there is no data validation. Anybody can enter alphabetic characters in a phone field, right? Maybe in text field, they put in the number, you want some values. Instead of putting numbers, they have put some characters there. In date field, you have put some junk characters. So there is no validation. You cannot use that data. That would be filled with garbage. In order to force people to enter the right formatted data, these kind of fields would be handy for you to enforce that. That is why we are choosing if you need a true and false only options that are there, probably select a checkbox. If you are putting some currencies, and for a currency field, is how different is a currency field and number field? Why not use a number field? You see, User can enter any number, leading zeros are removed, and enter, it can be decimal also. So why not use a number field instead of, why they have created a currency field?
The currency will not have decimals.
Why not? Currency field, of course, will have decimals. Let's create a currency field. You see, the length is there with the decimal places. However, you want to do here, you have to remove, you will lessen it from here. If you add 3 here, you will have 15 here. So it should be total up is 18 length. That is it. Currency and number field. Let's see the number field. I can change this to 15.3. Depends on, so this is exactly same. So why not use a number field, and why did they take so much time to create a currency field? What is the benefit of it?
Number field can be started with zero.
No, it cannot be. Leading zeros are removed. Salesforce always removes leading zeros. If you want a leading zero, you have to use a text field. What is the benefit of using a currency field and not a number field? Any ideas? You are looking at a value of a currency field, which is maybe 7.50. Number is also 7.50. But a very crucial information which is missing in the number is what is the exact currency type, right? 7.50 is dollars, 7.50 is INR, 7.50 is AUD, Singapore value, what, ruble, anything, euros, what is this value? What is the currency type? That is missing in number field, right? But when you come to a currency field, that is already there. You can choose that automatically. That is the USD, is the INR, or anything else. Multi-currency setup is possible. You can switch on multi-currency, and then based on that, you can choose your currency and currency type, and you can choose the currency value. So if you use number field, you have to create another pick list value probably to support it, and you have to say that choose your currency type here. So instead of creating two fields, you are basically creating one field now, which has both the information, the currency information, as well as the currency type information, as well as the currency value information. So currency is basically number plus currency type. Okay. So then what is this pick list? I see two pick lists, a pick list and pick list, multi-select pick list.
It gives options as a drop-down.
Yes, it gives options as a drop-down. So if I go and choose a pick list, I can choose, you see, use a global pick list value. That means you can inherit this from a global pick list value. You have saved it. So you want to reuse that set of values again and again. Then you can use it from a global pick list value. And do we have anything? No, we do not have. So let's test the test name of the field and enter values here, like option 1, option 2, option 3, right? Play around with these values. You can restrict these values, or you can make it free from text. Even if this dropdown is there, you can still type into it. So it will work as a dropdown as well as text field, both. You can set any of these as a default value. You can display this in alphabetical order if you want. Every field will have a help text. Help text will be additional information, that is this. You can make this field required. Same thing. Yeah. So play around with this information. So this is the, these are the drop-down values can be, what is the difference between pick list and multi-select? In pick list, you can choose only one object, one value. In multi-select pick list, you can choose more than one value. Yeah, that's the only difference. there are many kind of text fields. Text field is basically a combination of letter and characters. Text field also can be 255 characters. Text area can also be 255 characters. But in text area, you can use enter character. So you can break the line. In text field, you cannot break the line. Text area can save enter. So it can break the line, separate the line. Text area long is just more values of characters, but this will not show up in UI. This is just a backend value. This text box has also formatted text, so you can make a bold, italics, and so on. This will not come out in reports. Long text and reached area will not come in reports. You will show in UI, but not come in reports. And text encrypted is basically a value wherein you put some values which is maxed out. Right? Some crucial information, but that is maxed. Encrypted value. Time is a new field which has come very late. That is, it only stores the time information. Right? And URL is basically a URL information. So if an email is explanatory, date and date time, what is the difference? Date is only the date part of a date, and date time means date plus the time information. So date and time, this put together is date time. Okay. And these are the lookup relationship. External lookup we'll ignore for now. This is a very sophisticated relationship. We'll not talk about this. We'll talk about formula and rollup summary in subsequent classes. But let's look at this lookup relationship. You see, master data relationship is not shown here because I am on which object? I am creating on an account object, right? So I cannot create a master detail object because it is only possible in custom object, right? So let's see. Let's create a custom object first. How do I create a custom object? A new table. Here is a custom object. What information should I, okay. Before that, I think I did not complete my GST creating of the account. Let's create that first. Then we'll move to custom. So on my account object, I did not create any custom field. Let me create a custom field, which is called GST. What kind of field will that be? The text field, right? Which can store my GST information. Probably, I don't know, it is 70 characters or 13 characters, I forgot. GST number. By default, let's use the whole title length 255, but you can adjust this to whatever title length is needed. I am not making it required or unique, but you can. If you make it unique, then basically if you are trying, if it duplicates by any chance, it will throw an error. And you can make it unique based on case sensitive or insensitive versions. What is external ID? We'll talk about it maybe in the next class. So when you create a new field, you have to assign this to a profile, as profile is basically the most important part, which we discussed in last class, that is important for creating any user or login. So profile is basically a user type. So you have to give this access to this field to every user type. I'm giving to every user type, right? And also I am, it is saying that, do you want to add this to account screen? Is saying I want to go ahead because I want to add it automatically. You may choose to not add it to any of these sections, or you can do that and add it manually later. You can go and update these layouts later. Yeah, for now, let's add it and save it. When you add it and save it, and you refresh this screen, account screen, it takes a while to reflect because it's a caching there. So let's go and see the edit field. It shows up immediately here. Oh, GST number is showing up. Yeah. So I have created a new object, a new field here now. GST number. But I'm not happy with the position where it is set up, right? I want to move it on the right side. Where will I go and make the changes? Play around, right? As I said. In the account itself, in the next field is a page layout. As it is, these are the four page layouts we have for account. Why are four page layouts important? Why are we creating multiple page layouts?
Yeah, like the according to that requirement, like which type of product it is, like based on that, the fields will display over there.
Which type of product it is?
Like no, product, like what business. Operation, what business operation is there?
No. Nothing with the operation. You gave, what is the name it is suggesting? Account marketing layout, account sales layout, account support layout, account layout. Let's see the project layout assignment. Yes. You see? It is assigned to profiles. Every profile will have a different layout. See, the marketing layout has been assigned to the marketing users. Sales layout has been assigned to sales profiles. Support layout is assigned to the support profile users. Rest of the people have default account layout. Similarly, the system administrator, this is my profile, right? I'm logging with system administrator. I can go ahead and change this. I can do an edit assignment. Probably authenticated web user or chatter free users, everything, this kind, like force.com free user. I want to change this to support layout. Similarly, I can change my own layout also. So a layout, where does this reflect? Layout is the screen wherein we show the field and field values. This will impact in this screen, this detail screen. Yeah, this is the impact area. This one and the edit button, this one is the same field layout. So if you go and do a create, this is, I am on the account. Let's go to the account. I am on the account layout. So if I create a new account, this is the layout. The same layout is here on that edit. The same layout is there on the details. It's the same thing. Got it? What is the GST number? Did I add to the account or did I add to opportunity? Yeah, GST number is that in the account, right? So I added a new field. So if this is added under annual revenue, right? You see on the left side, if I go to the edit, you see it is annual entry on the left side. If I go and create a new account, it is under annual revenue on the left side. I want to change that. I want to bring it on the right side. So I will check which profile am I, or I want to change the profile layout for in which type of users. Go and check the layout. There, every type of user might have the same layout or they might have different layout. What is the benefit of different layout?
The person means who is in the profiles, he needs to know the information. Only the information is required.
Absolutely right. So I want to don't clutter his screen with unnecessary things on which he does not even work. Maybe the marketing people don't need to see the sales related fields. Absolutely worthless. That will only enlarge their screen and they can put garbage information in there. I don't want them to even look see those field values. I want to give only specific information which is applicable for them and their business process. So probably I will have separate screen with separate fields for separate kinds of people, right? That is the whole point of having different layouts. So if I go and do a setup and I go to account screen, I can see a layout and I can see, I am system administrator. My layout is the default layout. I will go forward here. This is the layout screen. And I can go down. You see GST number is there on the right. So probably I will take it and I will put it here. Yeah. Maybe. The rest looks pretty much simple. So if I do that and I save it, Does it impact here? I will go and refresh my UI. I will go to account. And can I check that layout is, it has impacted everywhere? You see, GST number is on the right now. Similarly, if I go to a BCCI, I go to edit, the GST number is on the right now. I go to the detail screen, the GST number is on the right now. Yeah. A table can have four operations. Create, read, update, and delete. In this CRUD operation or CRUD operation, which we say in a table for on the records, for working on any specific record, you need the screen for read operation, create operation, and edit operation. For delete, you do not need a screen. For delete, you need a prompt. This is the prompt. And if you want to select this account, this is it. You don't need the screen. So this layout is basically giving the screen details, field details for create, read, and create, read, and edit operations. So layout impacts these three operations. And delete operation does not have a layout impact. Same place layout is used for create, read, and edit operation. For you, if you one layout is assigned to you, this kind of users, you will be using only your layout. It can get complicated with record type. That we will discuss later. Right now, we are not going to discuss and burden you guys. So right now, we'll go one by one. So what happened? What did we see? The last part of today is creating a new table. So just like these are standard objects and standard fields, let's see one more time before we move on. So you see fields, you see the __C, these are the custom fields which I have created. Which field did I create? GST number, right? This is __C. That is why it is showing up. Any field which is __C is basically a field created by us, not provided by Salesforce by default. And that we call a custom field. This is a standard object account, which has standard fields as well as custom field. Similarly, I can create a custom object. I am creating a registration object, okay? Just the name would do, and I save it. Yeah. So now I have a custom object for registration. How do I add value or records into this table? Table is created. If I go to the list of all objects, here you see the registration is __C, so it's a custom object. If you go and field and relationship, I did not create any field, right? But still it is showing four fields. These are the standard fields of a custom object. We talked about four fields, right? Apart from that, the ID field is also there, which is not shown here. So if I go to the workbench and see now this field that is already created for you. You see, registration __C. So see how many fields are there. Yeah, but not all fields you're seeing on the screen, but anyway. So ID field is something which you are not seeing. Created by an I date, basically these two things. Out of that, created by is something which you see here. Last modified by, you are saying this both a lookup to user object.
Huh?
Owner is also a lookup to user object. And there is only a name field, which is a mandatory field. Every object will have a name field, which is mandatory field. Okay. And this mandatory field, you can change this to a text field, which is by default it is, but you can always change this to make it an auto number if you want. Go ahead and change this to an auto number. Then you have to give a format of this auto number and a start value, right? What was the display format? Probably R hyphen, maybe 0000, R hyphen, and the starting number would be with 1, and I save it. When you make an auto number, Salesforce generates that number for you. But where will I put the value? Where is this registration? Do I have it? No, I can't see. There is no tab in Salesforce to use and fill data, right? I have this table here though. I can make some inserts here directly. I can put some, we'll talk about these inserts and so on from the backend. But where in the UI will I see? Your CRUD operations for this table is not enabled. You are not able to put data to this table from your UI till you create a tab for it. In Salesforce, everything is tab, or the CRUD operations screens are created when you create a tab. Where do we create a tab? I have to create a tab here. And here I have to create a new tab with this object, which is the registration object. Choose a color, that's it, and save it. And this tab can be made default on. That means tab is visible to you. You can choose to hide this tab for some people if you want. Let's make it visible for people. And you can add this tab to different applications. Probably I will only add this to my sales application. I don't need this to be added. So when I create this tab and I refresh the screen, and I go back to my salesman thing, here now I search for a registration. I see a registration tab. Yeah, now I can create a registration. If I save, immediately some data will be created here, but let's wait for it. What I want to do is that I want to associate these registrations with my account. What kind of field is possible? What fields should I have to use to associate this with account?
Lookup or master detail field.
Absolutely right. So let's go and choose master detail this time, because now you see that when you have created a custom object, I will create maybe 2 fields. You see, there's an owner field here, right? When I create a master detail, you'll see this field vanishes. Now I am getting a new field called master detail list. I will choose account object as my relation. So this becomes my parent. And next, so I have to add this to, I have to give access to this new field, just like that, to all profiles. And of course, I have to put this field in my layout, registration layout, right? And also this related list will be created because this is the account child. Now it has become account child. So this related list will call, it will be called registrations. And this related list can be pushed in all account layouts, right? Because you can see child from your parent. So what happens now? If I go to the registration screen, registration tab, what is happening here? Okay, now you see, you can choose a account here and save it. When you save it, you see the registration name is automatically created by. And now the account you have chosen and the fee and the records are getting created. It works just like a lookup, right? And when it works like a lookup, if you go to I choose specify cap. This is the registrations, right? And I can see this record here as my child object. Similar to a lookup, right? It works. But there are many, many benefits of using master detail relationship. You can show information from the child to in the parent if you use a master detail relationship. We'll get into details in subsequent classes. Today, I won't be overburdening you any further. Please go ahead and play around. That is very, very crucial. Otherwise, whatever we are discussing on the sessions would not be of much benefit. Yeah, and you will keep forgetting. So once again, for the new people, please register yourself to trailhead.salesforce.com. This is the site. Register yourself. This is a free site. And on that, you search with get. If you are unaware of Trailhead, get start. You search with Trailhead first, how to use Trailhead. There is a trail. Don't go with module. Get started with Trailhead is the module name. Yeah, and you can choose this button as your favorite. This will bookmark it. This get started with Trailhead and then get started with, and then basically admin beginner. This is the crucial module. This you should mark it, admin intermediate. And admin advanced, there is another trail part. Please note this should be a trail, not a module. A trail is a collection of modules. So admin beginner, admin intermediate, admin advanced. These are the three materials you should first study. We'll go into development later. But we'll first complete the admin things. You should know what is the out-of-box features of Salesforce before you move and customize that. Without doing it, every developer is an administrator. Not every administrator is a developer. Right, so very, very crucial for you to understand the default features before you start and write code. So admin beginner, admin intermediate, admin advanced is a must three trails which you have to complete. All we are studying here on the class, I will not get into the nitty-gritties of the things which you can practice in this trail. We will discuss concepts and the business logic for those modules in these classes. So that is what this class is all about. This will show you how to do that thing. In this class, I will show you why to do that thing and when to do that thing. Clear? Any questions so far today? Go ahead.
No, they're good.
You're good? Okay. Then we'll close the call for today.
Animesh.
Yeah, go ahead.
Animesh. Yeah. I want to know about the workbench in the real. Means, what is the use of workbench? Can we say workbench that is metadata over there?
No, workbench is pure data. You're working on data here, right?
Yeah. So what is the real use in the real means when we use workbench in the real?
So this screen is basically when I'm going to this screen. Where is the screen? Yeah. So if I go and choose the app, sales app, right? These screens are used by the sales people or the business people, right? Every business people is creating data here. But can you create like 100 account at one shot? Can you create 200 contacts in one shot?
No, like
you cannot.
From the UI, it's not possible.
From UI, it is possible, but for a normal user, it is not possible. You as an admin can create multiple records at one shot. One of the tool is Workbench, wherein you can insert data. You can insert like 100 of records at one shot. You can create 100 accounts at one shot. So that is the job of an admin, right? To do backend job. They can play with data, they can play with metadata, everything. Playing with metadata is setup window. This is the setup window. Here we play with the metadata. Here we play with the data in bulk. Playing with data in Workbench is in bulk, and that is what the job of admin is, which is not a standard person cannot do it. If you want to modify 100 accounts at one shot, if you want to delete 200 record at one shot, these activities only an admin can be doing, right? And where will he do it? One of the tools is Workbench for working on data. There are multiple tools to work on data. We'll discuss those. Workbench is the browser-based tool, so I am choosing to use this.
Okay.
Did I answer your question?
Yeah, fine. Thank you.
Yeah, good. And the metadata changes is basically structure, creating structures, deleting structures, inserting more into the structures is all you do in the setup. What is a metadata? It's a description of data, right? Data is getting entered by the business users. And admin is creating the containers to enter data. These containers are called metadata. And what are these containers? The tables, the fields on that tables. These are containers. Play around. You will not mess up. If you mess up, go ahead and you can choose here on the left, on the top, sorry, in the trailhead. You can go to hands-on org. And you can create a new playground and you can launch it. This never expires if you keep on using it. And you play around. And if you're not happy or something get messed up, you're not able to recover it, yeah, create another playground. Nobody's stopping you to keep on spawning new playgrounds. If you don't use it, automatically it will expire and then later it will be cleared up from here. So don't worry about creating new playgrounds. Yeah, these playgrounds are basically your developer instances wherein only two users can be created, and we'll come to that later. But yeah, so these are all the Salesforce instances which you can fire from here. You will launch it here and it will open up. This does not need a user ID password. If you launch it from Trailhead, at some point you would need user and password. We'll come to that and we'll discuss how to create that. Right now everything is single sign-on from Trailhead. Okay. I think we'll close for the day. If no further questions are there, meet you next week.
Thanks.
Bye.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ramesh.
Thank you.